each and every last one of you can change your future. Snapshot, 13 years old, 14 years old, snapshot, freshman year, sophomore year, junior year, senior year, snapshot, within moments, high school will be over. You will be full grown adults. Either you did your best or you didn't do your best. If you scored high enough on the ACT or SAT or you didn't. If you read those books you were supposed to read or you borrowed your homework from your friend. If you did what your parents told you to do or you didn't. If you did your best or you didn't. Snapshot!
Making money for teens, and it's a teen financial education business for teenagers to help them start becoming more financially independent and responsible, not always having to rely on their parents' money and finances for the stuff they may want and need. So we have products that we've created. We have a CD series. We've recently published two books that teaches them just how they can start preparing for their future and avoid money problems.
That is, we went to the same school.
I was many years earlier.
Morgan Park Academy on the south side of Chicago. Good afternoon, my name is Sybil Wilkes. I'm from the Tom Joyner Morning Show, and I welcome you all to the Allstate Tom Joyner Family Reunion. It has been a wonderful weekend, and I appreciate you all coming in this afternoon. I know that there's still a lot going on and a lot on your plates, but this is a wonderful event, and I hope that you will garner as much from it as these young people have already, and in telling their stories, I think that you will be inspired and motivated, and I hope that this will take you to a whole nother level in your aspirations as you take your ideas from dreams to reality. I'll tell you a little bit about me and my dream. My dream has always been, from a very young age, to own a professional football team. Here I am still working the Tom Joyner Morning Show, but I still have such admiration for people who are able to do this, just that, to take their ideas and make them into reality. And we have a group of young people here this afternoon who are going to tell you their stories, and they're going to, I think, enthrall you and inspire you to be a part of a great idea generation. First of all, we're going to introduce all of the young people who are on the panel this afternoon, and then we're going to have a little bit of multimedia involvement, and then we'll ask questions, and you all will have an opportunity to ask your questions as well as we get through this hour. We don't have to cram as much, I understand, into a full hour because this room is not going to be occupied until 3 o'clock, so we have a little bit of time, but I do ask you to start formulating your questions and thinking about them as you would like to ask our guests this afternoon. First of all, I'm going to introduce them by name, but you will have an opportunity to hear more, and they will tell you about their history and their stories as we go through this afternoon. First of all, would you welcome Jordan Williams and Brandon Iverson. Hang on a second. Next, would you welcome Damon A. Williams. Ryan Pendleton. Next, we have a lady in the group. And a gentleman who is just a bundle of energy and has so much to offer, and he is fully prepared this afternoon. And I ask you to please welcome Brian Robinson. I'm sorry, I said Robinson, Brian Robinson, I'm sorry.
There was a Brian Robinson in my past. I'm sorry.
We're going to start off with Jordan and Brandon, and you have a little bit of a song that you'd like to introduce, as well as then we're going to get started with who you guys are, where you come from, who your people, and tell us your story. So let's hit with the song.
We knew that was a popular song for teens today, but we wanted to disprove it because it doesn't really go with what we're trying to say today, because in the song, Drake is saying that it's all about the money and it's all about the fame and you're successful and you shouldn't listen to what anybody says and just your money is in the center of your life. But when you become successful today, you can't, you know, have your money in the center of your life. You shouldn't value money. You shouldn't value what you do and what you do and how you did it to get to where you are today. So you shouldn't listen to the message, even though it's a nice beat and it's really popular today. You shouldn't listen to the lyrics of the message because it doesn't go with what successful people, you know, do today.
Tell us your story.
Well, our company is called Making Money for Teens, and it's a financial education company where we teach kids and teens how they can invest in the stock market and how they can start their own businesses and become financially literate today. And we started that company last year. And we actually first started our first company at the age of 10 together, and it was called Kids Toys Inc. And for about 4 years, we've been doing this for a long time.
A long time, 4 years. Let me ask you a question in terms of getting into such a business at such a young age, and you want people to know about the advice that you would give to someone who wants to create a small business or to create a successful business at a young age. Yes, sir. Jordan.
Well, I would say that the best way to start a business for teens is to start a business off of your passion and what you love to do. That's what me and Brandon always teach, because when you start a business off of what your passion is, it's really not work because you have fun doing it. So it's like waking up every day to do something you love. You don't look at it as work. You look at it as your hobby. So when you have a passion that you turn into a career, it instantly becomes successful.
You know, in college graduations, they always tell you, find what you love and you'll never work a day in your life. Is that what you all were aiming for? All right, so Brandon, you have mentors in your life, or how did you find one, and how did you go about doing that?
Well, our parents are our main mentors because they're entrepreneurs themselves, and we watched them create successful companies, and we thought that, why don't we start making money at a young age? So they advised us and given us guidance throughout our whole lives. And I think having a mentor is really important because they help you through everyday life.
Tell me about your business, if you can describe to people what you guys do and how it got started a little bit.
Well, the name of our business is Making Money for Teens, and it's a teen financial education business for teenagers to help them start becoming more financially independent and responsible, not always having to rely on their parents' money and finances for the stuff they may want and need. And so we have products that we've created. We have a CD series. We've recently published 2 books that teaches them just how they can start preparing for their future and avoid money problems as they get older.
And you have a website?
Right. We have a website called makingmoneyforteens.org. We're also on Twitter at MMFTCEOs and on Facebook.
That's a lot of letters.
MMFTCEOs and on Facebook at Making Money for Teens.
Making Money for Teens is the most important thing we need to remember.
Yes.
Because those of us that get up at 3:30 in the morning, we don't always have the capacity to write all those letters down. Damon Williams, you may know his name from the Tom Joyner Joyner Morning Show. That's his dad, who gives us seriously ignorant news on a regular basis. But this young man is giving us seriously important news and information. And we've seen an article about you in Black Enterprise magazine. I've had an opportunity to work with your dad. I met your mom years ago on the Fantastic Voyage, and she told me that we have something in common. That is, we went to the same school.
I was many years earlier.
Morgan Park Academy on the south side of Chicago. Share with people, but tell us about you and your business and your business acumen.
Okay, well, my name is David Williams. I'm 19 years old. I'm a junior at Grinnell College, so a small liberal arts school in Iowa, and I'm now a licensed financial consultant. But my story and how I got started, I've been kind of teaching or speaking about financial literacy to youth and teens, and actually adults, since I was about 9 years old. So I'm about 10 years in the game right now. And my story is, I actually got started, I bought my first stock, a share of Nike, when I was 5 years old, which is kind of my story. It kind of blends a lot with my message that I try to teach, because, you know, as young people, especially as young African Americans, it's very easy to get caught up as a consumer. So how I got started investing was as a consumer. So I was a passionate basketball player pretty much since I was a fetus growing up in Chicago.
Wow, that must have been painful for your mom.
Oh, yeah. The crossover's been nasty. So what happened was, growing up in the 90s, as a young basketball fan, you know, you had to have the latest Jordans every time they came out, which is like every 9 months. So I had feet that were growing really fast, and I was still asking for a $75, $80 pair of shoes at 4 or 5 years old. So my mom kind of saw that this was a troubled path that I was going down. Or maybe she was just tired of buying the shoes, so she challenged me and said, you know, you can't get another pair of shoes, Nike shoes or Jordan shoes or anything, until you save up to buy a share of Nike stock.
Wow.
So I didn't really care what she was talking about, I just really wanted my J's. So I just saved up ferociously, birthday money, Christmas money, and got a share that was like $33 at the time. But from
what is
that,
what is Nike trading at?
I can tell you exactly, but it's in like the $80 to $90 range.
It's a good investment.
Yeah. And so from that experience, I kind of learned the value of ownership and knowing where you put your money and how to kind of pay yourself and invest in yourself as you spend money in the marketplace. And so I kind of just try to teach that to my community and let people know that you should have an end in mind and think about the future and kind of not just think about instant gratification, but worry about the delayed satisfaction of saving for your future.
Can you go a little bit more into about the volatility, as you mentioned, in the stock market today? Because we know that every, what is it, 2 to 3 weeks, we're always talking about the highest of highs and the lowest of lows. And we see this up and down every day almost in the financial news market. Can you talk about that? And why it is important from your standpoint to invest as opposed to just putting it into a savings account, that money?
Yeah, well, you know, it's kind of hard. The news can deter you because we, you know, mainstream media is really fond of making everything really dramatic. So they really try to excite you or scare you every other day. So it's easy to be, you know, intimidated or disinterested in investing in the stock market because it seems like, you know, it's so easy to lose your money. But the key is to not gamble, but to actually do your diligence and research and know where you're putting your money, and to know that over time, you know, your investment will pay off if you've done your research. Because, for example, you know, since like the crash of 1929, if you're familiar with the Great Depression, there is no place you can put your money that has grown faster over a long period of time than in the stock market. But if you look at it day by day, it can kind of make you sick and make your stomach turn, like you're really on a roller coaster, because that's how much.
Yeah, we do feel sick.
It goes up and down. So really, why I think we have an advantage as young people is because we kind of have time on our side. So in the short run, it may incur some losses. But over time, it is up and down, it's gradually going up. So I just try to kind of teach people the history and know that history is cyclical, if I said that right, and that it repeats itself, and that over time, you know, your money will grow, and you will be investing in your future if you have the patience to kind of deal with the ups and downs.
So you're a buy and hold man?
I am.
You're a buy and hold as opposed to buying and selling?
Yes, and I think as a young person, one, you know, even myself, I don't have really the time or the mental capacity to every day be looking to buy here and sell there, but instead, that's, you know, trading. But instead to actually invest and to, you know, do something for the long run and invest in something that you really know and that's a staple in your community and in your life.
And in your business, you give people information and help them to guide them in those different companies and guide them where they can find that information.
Yeah, so I'm not an actual license. Like, I don't have a license to tell you what company to buy. So I never actually like give stock tips. But what I try to do is, you know, the teach a man to fish mentality and kind of show people just the tools that I use and kind of how I go about my decision-making process. So I just try to teach people how to be literate and to understand what they're doing to make, you know, valid decisions.
And so they won't come looking for you.
Right. It keeps me safe, too.
Ryan Pendleton is our next guest. And Ryan, you have a song that applies so aptly to your life. DJ? Did we lose our DJ? Did we lose the music?
You, lift you up and allow you to excel and realize your dream. One thing that I've seen that was very fortunate, very beneficial to me is getting mentors on my way to get into the aviation industry. A lot of times, in most cases, you're gonna have people that have already gone where you're trying to get to. So if you can get professionals that are already out in the industry or the different field that you're trying to go into and can kind of get taken under their wing, get them to kind of help you along. Me specifically, I've gotten really hand in hand with the organization of Black Aerospace Professionals. Got a lot of mentors within there, people that have gone off and are off in the aviation industry already. And without them, I don't know where I would be. So I mean, if moving forward, that's something I would really recommend everyone do, is look for these role models out there that they can help you move forward, really believe in yourself. Because it's like people always say, if you put your mind to it, if you can really believe in yourself, that's more than half the battle right there.
How does one get to the dream of commercial aviation, you said from birth, and then extend it to becoming a commercial pilot? What was your path like?
Yeah, my path, like I said, probably since about I was 5 years old, I always really wanted to go into aviation. For me personally, just because it incorporates all the different passions that I already like.
Which one?
I like to go fast. Now, you do that on the streets, you get pulled over, that's not good for your career, you don't want to have those speed tickets on there. So the airplane, I can go do 150 miles an hour every day on the ground when I'm taking off, and I get pulled over for it. So that was good. Like computers, video games, and things like that. If you've ever seen any of the new cockpits on these new airplanes, it really looks like a big video game. You got screens, buttons everywhere, really good for multitasking. Like to move around a lot, so I never have a stagnant view. Out the office window, essentially I can always be in a couple hours completely across the country, so that's something that I really like. And also, if you get up on the top, and the pay's not so bad either. So, kind of all those things together are really what I look at my entire life, so that's something I really enjoy doing.
Is it an expensive hobby to start out?
It can be, for sure. That's actually, looking back at the song in terms of those low points, and when you're trying to realize your dream, my flight training, it's something I came into, and it's something I had to really look at. It's like, I want to realize this dream, but getting up to a commercial pilot's license is not cheap, and I didn't have the money to do it. I think my flight training was somewhere around $50,000 or $60,000 just to get the training done. So that was a lot. I look at that, and I'm like, I don't have that kind of money. My parents have that kind of money, so how am I going to do it? So really staying motivated through school, going aggressively after that, looking for scholarships, doing anything you can really do and get the support that's out there to realize your dreams again. A lot of times it's going to seem hopeless, like there's no way you can achieve this, but if you really, really go after it, it's always going to be a way. another thing is, I even had, throughout my entire time, passing through airports and stuff, people saying, oh, don't go into the aviation industry, even other pilots kind of discouraging you, saying, no, don't go into this, going to something different. All kinds of different things, all kinds of obstacles that come up. So, like I said, I'm kind of a product of kind of pushing away all that negativity, pushing forward and still realizing what I do.
Thanks, Ryan. Who is Natalia McKnight?
I'm Natalia. I'm 25 years old. I'm from Gainesville, Florida. Go Gators. I graduated from the University of North Florida in 2010. And anyone who's a little older and has graduated, oh, I'm moving out and going to get the best paid job, 6 figures off the bat. Well, that didn't happen. So when that didn't happen, I turned to my parents. They worked for Allstate, and of course your parents kind of want you to do what they did.
Oh, so the family business.
Yes. And I was like, I don't want to do it. So I got a job with Avis Budget Group, and a few days after, before I was about to move in my apartment in Jacksonville, I got let go. And I called my parents and I said, you know, Mom, Dad, I don't know what I'm supposed to do from here. You know, I signed my lease already. Mm-hmm. And my mom and my father both told me, you lost a job to gain a career. And I think that was one of the most powerful things I've heard to help me move forward. I got over it, I packed up my stuff, Dad, I'm moving home. Moved home, I worked at my mom's agency, and the more I was there, the more I realized this is an industry that changes people's lives. It can change it for the better or the worse, depending on how you deal with it. But day to day, I go in my office, I don't know if I said it, I own an Allstate agency, sorry.
We're going to get to that.
Okay.
We got y'all stay quiet.
I go into work every day, and I know that I'm changing somebody's life.
How about from the, because we have all these fine-looking young men, but I am interested in your perspective as a woman, and a black woman, especially in the business world. Any obstacles, anything that you have faced, or perhaps even stories from your mom in preparing you for this?
Well, my mom is not in here, so I can say that. She's a lot more stern than I am. Mm-hmm. I'll say that. She's a lot more stern, whereas I am my father's child, and I'm really bubbly, I'm really nice, I like to be around people. And some people don't like to see that in an office setting. They want someone who's
that stern person.
Yes, who's that stern person, where some people would kind of grab you by the collar and sit you down. I'll take your hand and hold and sit down with you and kind of go from there. So it has been a challenge. It's definitely a challenge in any industry. I'm sure being a young black pilot, and Damian, Brandon, and Jordan as well. It is, especially being a woman. People don't normally like to take advice from a woman, but when you know what you're talking about and you gain the trust of people, they'll take care of you.
And the business itself, insurance, is not always a sexy business and a sexy topic, either. Yeah.
About that, you know, normally people, when you think insurance, the first thing you think about is the car and auto. Mm-hmm. And it's so much more out there. My first week opening my office, my client's husband had just passed away. And doing a death claim for life insurance is one of the hardest things to do, because you have this wife, this mother, this grandmother, who you have to sit down and a check to. And although we don't make funeral arrangements, we don't really get into the personal aspect of what's going on in the household at the time. But we're kind of there, their saving grace, so to say. If someone wouldn't have sat down and said, hey, this is what you need for your family, this is what you need for your future, there would be no one to turn to. We've seen people have to sell cars to bury their loved ones, have to sell their homes, have to go back to work at the age of 70 just to provide, whereas our industry, we definitely look out for that family and say, this is what you need now, not 10 years from now, because you may develop something that we can't insure, but you need it.
So it is a family business all around, isn't it?
For the most part.
Yeah, it can be.
Yeah.
Okay. And Brian Rice. Brian Rice is a man of energy and passion and direction, as you can see from over here on the side. He not only has a story to tell, but he has things for you to check out at brianrice.com. And Brian, you are going to take us to a whole nother level and introducing yourself.
Snapshot! Daddy! You said you wanted to be a pilot when you grew up. Daddy! You said when you were young, you used to fly around the house acting like you were an airplane. You said your dream was to become a pilot. All you ever thought about was becoming a pilot. Daddy, why didn't you go to college? Daddy, why do you have to keep fixing that broke car over there? Dad, why can't you just buy a new car? Dad, why do we have to live in this community over here? Dad, why can't I have my own car when I turn 16? Why can't I have my own room? Dad, why didn't you follow your dreams? Dad, why didn't you follow your dreams? Children ask their parents a lot of questions. Some questions they don't ask, some questions they won't ask. The father speaks, son, daughter, the real reason why I didn't go to college was because when I was your age, those C's, even B's, and D's that you were making, I was making too. I didn't understand the importance of grades. You know that algebra you don't like? You know that chemistry you don't like? That Shakespeare you're supposed to read that you don't want to read? I didn't read it either. I didn't want to do it either. It wasn't that I couldn't do it, but I chose not to do it because I didn't understand the purpose of it. And because of that, when it was time to go to college, I didn't have a high enough GPA. I didn't have a high enough score on the ACT. I didn't excel in the way I was supposed to excel. And because of that, I am where I am today, working a job I don't like, doing what I don't want to do. I wish I could give you more, but I can't go back and change the past. Each and every last one of you can change your future. Snapshot, 13 years old, 14 years old, snapshot, freshman year, sophomore year, junior year, senior year, snapshot. Within moments, high school would be over. You would be full grown adults. Either you did your best or you didn't do your best. If you scored high enough on the ACT or SAT or you didn't. If you read those books you were supposed to read or you borrowed your homework from your friend. If you did what your parents told you to do or you didn't. If you did your best or you didn't. Snapshot. Can I have all the women to please stand up? All the young ladies to please stand up. The number one reason why a lot of women give up on their dreams is because they have an unplanned baby too soon without the proper support system. Just imagine I'm that future baby in your belly. Each one of you will probably be mothers when you're older. You'll be grandmothers. Each one of you will be that. Imagine I'm that future baby in your belly. Mama, don't sleep with that irresponsible boy this weekend. That irresponsible boy is going to become my father. And because he becomes my father and he's irresponsible, he's not able to take care of you. He's not able to take care of me. Therefore, you have to give up on your dreams. You have to give up on your idea of success. And you have to support me. Mom, I can wait 5 more years to be born. Mom, I can wait 10 more years. I can wait 20 more years. Go after your dreams. Provide me with the best life I possibly can have. Do your part. Do your part. An above average woman is confident. She's full of self-esteem. She's persistent. She's persuasive. She communicates effectively. She's strong and independent by herself. She don't need a man to do that. A man only compliments her. He does not complete her. You may sit down. But you are the future mothers. You are the future of the first ladies. You are the future leaders. You are the future CEOs. You are the future. Can I have all the young men to please stand up? All the young men, please stand up. Do you know who you are? Do you know who you are? You are the beginning of a new family tree. It's not just about you. What you do today affects those coming behind you. What you do today, don't care, it's not just about you. You got a little brother looking up at you, a little sister looking up at you, it affects them too. But not only that, you want to have a son or a daughter one day. And if you do it right, you can create the best life possible for them. Do you know who you are? Do you know who you are? You are the future fathers. You are the future engineers. You are the future businessmen. Your job in life, I don't care what these rap songs say, I don't care what reality TV says, your job in life is not to chase women. Your job in life is not to chase women. Our women do not have enough good men to marry because too many men are copying their lifestyle by the way they see on TV. Your job is not that. Your job is not to play video games. Your job, your purpose in life is not to play sports all the time. Your job, your purpose is to protect and to provide for your family. The way you protect and provide for your family is by investing in your mind. Too many men are not reading. Too many men are not doing what they're supposed to do because they're hanging with their friends. Don't let that be you. Your job is to protect and provide for your family. That's your job. Step into that role. The next time you have homework you don't want to do, do it. Because it's not just about you. There's somebody coming after you. You are the future. Walk into your future role. Walk into it. You are the future. You are the future made in governors and presidents and CEOs. You are the future. You may sit down. My name is Brian K. Rice. Originally from Birmingham, Alabama, I live in Houston, Texas. I've been an engineer for 10 years. Over the last few years, I was helping people so much, they were like, Brian, why don't you become a motivational speaker? I was like, that's not a bad idea. But then I thought about it a little bit more, but it's not just about me speaking up here today. I understand what my purpose is. I understand what my passion is. My passion is helping others. That's my passion. If you ask me what my purpose is today, I can tell you right now. To inspire and to help others. You have a purpose in you, and you need to understand what it is. And you need to walk in it. To inspire and to help others. That young boy who drops out of school over there, I want to help him get back into school. That's what I want to do. I want to get him focused back on his education. That's what I want to do. That young girl, that may be you, that's struggling with low self-esteem. Some girl is calling you ugly. Somebody's calling you this. They're calling you that. You put makeup on your face. You put all that on your face. Baby, you don't need makeup. Your face is perfectly made up. Everything about you was created for a reason. Every detail on your body, everything was created to represent you. You have to know that you are beautiful. You can't let anybody knock you down. You have to know who you are. Can't let anybody knock you down. That woman, that single mother, or whomever, struggling trying to figure out how she's gonna provide for her kids. That's me. That's when I come in. I want to help her. I want to help her find resources, find jobs, find a business, start a business. That's what I want to do. I understand my purpose, and I'm walking in that purpose. Over here, you see banners. A lot of times I go around the room at a high school and I ask students, what do they want to be? I hear the same five careers, the same 10 careers, an engineer, a teacher, a basketball player, a football player, a baseball player, some other sport player, a bunch of sport players, entertainer, something else. I always hear that out like, wait a second. That means I can't only be, or only want to be what they see. There's a whole lot more out there. That's the reason why you have to read. That's the reason why you have to read and invest in you. Over here, on the career banner, there's over 550 different types of careers in this country. You can go to the Occupational Outlook Handbook and you can find those. You can look it up. Over there, the business list. There are over 1,500 different types of businesses in this country. I can't have each and every last one of you thinking about the same thing. There's a whole lot more out there for you. There's a whole lot more out there for you. Walk into your purpose. Step into your dream. Step into your future. Thank you. Thank you.
If that doesn't fire you up, I don't know what will. Ladies and gentlemen, another round of applause for Tom Joyner. I'm going to ask you all, in terms of your own businesses, and Brian, I'm going to start with you, this is your question. Why do you think most people fail? And how do we counteract that?
Why do I think most people fail? Most people think they're gonna be kids for forever. A lot of adults think they're gonna be kids for forever. My best friend in the room, he told me something one day that he heard. And he said, Brian, a lot of people think this is Peter Pan. There is no Never Never Land. You do grow up. You have to step into your future. You have to understand that within a few years, you will be a full grown adult. And you have to attach to a vision for your life. And after you attach to a vision for your life, you need to work out a plan to reach that vision. And then when you don't want to do something, one day you don't want to do something, you have to say, discipline is doing the things I do not want to do, but need to do. I'm going to do it. I don't care how tired I am. I don't care if I don't like the subject. I'm going to do it. The second part of that question, it's because people sell. That's probably number two, maybe number one reason why I think most people fail. They sell. Les Brown, he's here today. He's not in this room, but he's here today. And the quote that he said sticks out to me every day. Most people fail, not because they aim too high and miss, but most people fail because they aim too low and hit. I know a lot of athletes, they go to college, they major in PE, they major in education, and there's a whole lot more in them. I know a lot of people who, they started off in engineering, they changed their major just so they can find an easier major. There's nothing wrong with being a teacher, but for some people, that's not your purpose, that's not your dream, that's not your success story. But a lot of people are taking the easy route out. Don't take the easy route out. My sister and my brother, they're great examples. They're great examples. My sister became a doctor. And because she became a doctor, it made me work hard. My brother became a physical therapist and started his own business, and it made me work hard. Those were their dreams. They went after me. I'm walking in my dream with my oldest brother. He got drafted first round out of high school to play baseball. And I'm gonna tell you the other reason. Sad to me. I might even shed a tear. But my oldest brother, drafted first round out of high school. Ranked number 3 in the country in his position. And he played 5 years of minor league ball. The only reason why he's not there today is because he didn't give the effort he was supposed to give. He was too good, and he didn't know it. He didn't work when he wanted, when he needed to work. And now, every year when baseball season comes back around, he sees these people playing behind him, making $30 million, $40 million, $60 million a year. And he say, that should have been me, but he didn't give his best. That's the other reason. So what I tell you to do, give your best, and then and only then will you know if that dream is for you. Then and only then, give your best at all times.
Let me go over to this side, and Jordan and Brandon, at your advanced age of 14, have you all come into questions of failure and not succeeding, and what might hold you all back, or your peers back, and what advice do you give them?
Well, I would say everybody experiences failure at some time in their life or in their career, but the important thing is that you learn from it, and you don't stick on it, but when you have failure, when you do experience that, you don't let it get you down, and don't let it make you doubt yourself, but that you learn from it and make it, let it become you better. And so me and Brandon have definitely had failures in our 4 years of experience. We've had times where we just didn't think that would be good to keep going, that we should give up on what our passion was and try to find something new. But we stuck to it, and we have a lot of commitment to what we do and to the teens and kids that we help. And so we're committed to not let our failures get us down, but to help it make us better.
And you have each other to keep each other going,
right,
too.
Yes.
Is that right? Mm-hmm. Latalia, what about you? Talk a little bit about, you already gave us an example of starting out in the business world, and just before you even started, you were laid off. How do you keep going, and can you address the topic of how people keep going in the face of failure?
With failure, I think a lot of people fail because when they fail, they don't find it in themselves to get back up. It's difficult. Life is difficult. I'm only 25, and I've seen a lot of obstacles in my life, in my friends' lives, in everyone's life. If Shaq quit every time he missed a free throw,
oh my.
That would be kind of the definition of failure. But look at where Shaq is. I use Shaq because everyone knows who Shaq is. Not just Shaq, but Bruno Mars. Everyone know who Bruno Mars is? Bruno Mars signed with Motown years ago, and you would naturally think, being with Motown, you would have a successful career. It didn't happen that way. Mm-hmm. He never gave up. Bruno Mars pushed forward. He signed with another label, and he's one of the most recognized names in the music industry today. So I think a lot of the times, failure is not only because, like Brian said, people aim too low, they give up. And they don't really understand, I failed at this because this isn't what I was called to do in life. I need to go figure out what I need to do. And instead of figuring out what they need to do, they go back to what they did before they failed, because that's what was worth.
And was safe, too. Yeah. What about you, David? And you talk risk and failure a lot in your business. Can you talk to failure and keeping going?
I think people only fail when they think they fail. To be honest, I think failure is really a state of mind, and it actually doesn't exist. It's really just when you accept your circumstances and give up. For example, Steve Jobs was fired from Apple. That doesn't even make sense, right? I think the 90s and the 80s, he was actually let go from the company he created. And the average person that could crush him, he could just give up, and he's like, I'm not done with computers. I'm about to go sell burgers or something. But he had the perseverance to stay passionate and stay relevant in his goals, and he actually reconnected with his company. So I think people often confuse detours in their path with dead ends. You're on a journey, you're on a path, and there is an end stop. or an end in mind, but if you stop on your path, you know, that's the only way you can fail. If you give up at every pothole or every, you know, sign of struggle or obstacles, it's really, you just have to keep going and be persevering.
Ryan, I'm going to ask you the same question. I'm also going to ask people to start, if you have not already formulated your questions, we have a place here where you can, we have a mic, so I'll come out there with my microphone, and questions that you have of our panel. This includes young people as well as their parents that may be in the audience that want to get some questions and some points across to their children. Ryan, tell me about failure and keeping going from your perspective, from the aviation, which is highly competitive and expensive.
It is competitive and expensive. I would first like to just kind of echo, they hit most of the points that I would normally hit. Travels right into aviation. So this will happen when you go last. With aviation, obviously, it kind of depends. You don't want failure to happen when you're actually flying people around. It's probably not so good. Just like anything else, you're really going to want to take it as not only a learning experience, but the best thing I can see to do is if you do have a failure, have an issue, and what you perceive as failure, take the feelings that you have from that and flip them around. Use it as motivation to accelerate yourself, to better yourself, and make it so that, obviously, if you think you failed, most of the time it's not going to make you feel very good. Use that as motivation so that that does not happen to you again. Just put in that much extra effort to rectify the issue that you had that kind of put you in that bad situation and continue doing that through everything else that you learn going forward.
We have a question here. Yes, ma'am. What is your name and how old are you?
I'm DJ and I'm 10 years old.
And you have a question
for whom?
For all of them?
I have a question.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
That's okay. I am DJ Layla J's mom. And DJ Layla J is 10 years old, and she's been DJing professionally since she was 7. She actually performed, was very fortunate to perform yesterday and the day before for the kids and teens. As her mom, there are certain things that I tell her as which are good advice, but I'm her mom. So we know how that kind of, she brushes that off her shoulders. But how do you balance being young and wanting to participate in extracurricular activities in school, i.e. cheerleading, football, basketball? But see, as a DJ, most of her gigs are on Fridays and Saturdays, which X's all that out. So, do you have any advice that you would give her on how to balance that?
I don't mind jumping in. My name is Brian K. Wright again. When I was in high school, as well as college, I played baseball. And even in college, I played baseball, joined a fraternity. But one thing that I realized, especially whether it was in high school or whether it was in college, the moment I had free time, I had to do my work right then and there. Some of you will go to college one day, and a lot of times there are gaps in between your classes. Don't wait tonight to the night to do your work. When you get home, a lot of you probably take naps when you get home. You're probably watching TV. You're doing different things. You're talking on the phone. You don't have that much time. Remember this, there's only 168 hours in every week. Only 168 hours every week. You're usually in school for 8 hours of that day. And then you probably go home, you probably play a sport or you participate in something, and that's probably another 2 to 3, maybe 4 hours in some cases. Then you gotta carve out the rest of your time. You have to set your priorities straight. You can't just hang around with your friends. You just can't follow them. You have to focus on you. It's your future, not your friend's future. It's your future.
But Brian, isn't there a time that you can carve out for having fun and being a kid? You know what I mean? Because she has a career, she's got her gig, and normally the time when you do have fun with your friends is the weekend when she's working. So how do you find that balance?
I go ahead, Brian, if you ask this.
I don't mind.
I know for me, I had a great social life in high school.
But you found it. How did you sound like a man that makes lists. You know what I mean? You sound like, okay, at 8:05 I'm here, at 8:11 I'm here. So
I am there.
I know you're tight. Even if I can't remember closer to this young lady's age. How do you find the balance so that you can be, I don't want to say a child, I don't want to say a kid, but be a young person and all of that entails?
Because now that I'm a little bit older, I can kind of look back, because I've been through similar experiences, because growing up, I was an avid basketball player. I'd be on three teams at a time. I would also speak. I acted. And, you know, I had a social life. And I think the key to, like, that balancing act is establishing a team and kind of don't try to do it alone and be upfront about it. So all my coaches knew that, you know, I'm a speaker and I'm an actor, so sometimes I may have to leave. All my teachers knew, you know, all my friends knew, all my parents knew, just communication. And treating everybody as your team, because people are there to support you, so they understand that it's amazing that at 10 years old you have a business and a craft that you're pursuing, and you should find people that support that and are understanding of that. Because you know, whether you're playing soccer or you know it's a party or something, they understand that you know what you're doing is a little bit more important than your future for that one practice or for that one dance. So you kind of get, you know, have a balance in that. It takes a lot of miles on your car because you might have to leave early for stuff and drive far, but you know, you can kind of just push your limits if you have people around you that understand and support you. I think that's the easiest way.
So communication is a big part of it. Yeah. I don't even know. You want to be a part of this team,
right,
or this organization, but you also have other obligations.
Yes,
yes sir. You guys have anything to add to that?
Yeah, me and Jordan both struggle with managing our business sometimes because we have to manage school and extracurricular activities, but we've learned that we have to set our priorities straight and make sure that we have everything we need in our business done before we start working on like going out with our friends and different things like that. But if you're really dedicated to becoming a DJ and using that as a career, then you have to manage your priorities now and be able to set your schedule so that you have to have sacrifices. You may not be able to go out with your friends and go to the movies all the time. You may have to work on whatever you want to do for your career, but you have to manage your priorities now so that you can have a successful future.
Any more questions do we have out here? Because we are getting short on time, and I want you all to have an opportunity to wrap up, to give your email addresses, your websites, as well as your Twitter handles and all of that. Do you have a question, sir? Okay.
I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
Thanks. Hi, my name is Sabrina, and I'm one of those tough moms. I have two boys that I'm raising, and my question is, I'm always trying to push them to be their very best all the time and to find out what they're good at. Anybody can answer, were you pushed into what you're doing, or did you just like it and then start to love it? How'd you come about
it? I'll actually answer that first. In undergrad, I actually started out in athletic training because I just thought I was the best basketball player, and I looked back, I was not that good. And I started athletic training, and once we got to anatomy and physiology, and I looked at the frog, and I just couldn't do it. So, of course, I called mom, dad, I gotta do something else. Okay, you don't have that much time to figure out what you want to do during undergrad. The semester's going to start with or without you, and the class you're going to start if you're there, if you're not. Changed my major to business, and I had the option, business, engineering, education, but it was something about the business side that I enjoyed. And in undergrad, you have 2 years to figure out what you want to do, and those classes are called general ed. Figure it out, man. Don't wait till your junior year to say, oh, I think I want to be a nurse. I think I want to be a doctor, or whatever you want to be. Figure it out then, and from there, you can always switch. You can always go back. You can do whatever you want to do with your life. That's positive. But it definitely, I don't think it's a matter of what your parents feel like you should do, but figure out your own passions. Take different paths, take different classes, read books, like Brian said, read a book sometimes. It's okay to read a book, guys, it's okay. That's probably the easiest way to figure out what it is that you want to do.
I agree with her also. I definitely think that it's important for parents to help your children with choosing their career, but I definitely don't think that you should force them into doing a certain career because that might not be their passion. It might be the parents' passion, but it might not be what the child wants to do. So, and you want the child to have fun with what they're doing in the future. So I think that, you know, with me and Brandon, our dads definitely help us along, but with starting this business, it was something that we wanted to do. And with everything they do, that we do, they help us along the way, but they sort of let us go also experience things for ourselves. But we also have their advice to help us along the way.
So you have backup.
Right, we have backup.
You have backup. Anybody else like to answer that parental question?
I can.
Yes, sir.
Was I pushed? Absolutely. But I think Brandon made a big distinction between push and force. You know, because I was 7 years old, I wasn't waking up like, yo, mom, turn on the stock market, let's see what's happening. And it wasn't, you know, naturally in me. But the key is to make it somewhat fun. So, you know, with my field, it was learning about money. So, like, making it tangible and, like, not just making it reading and sit down and do this. It's, let's make this fun, let's make this an activity, let's make a game with it. Let's go out and do something. And kind of when you're pushing a child, I think the difference is just making them do something and kind of having them understand why they're doing a certain activity or a certain field or goal. And to let them know that, you know, to have higher expectations for themselves and hold themselves to a higher standard. I think once you establish that, it's easier to push and motivate once they're having fun and also expect, you know, something higher than the norm for themselves.
And there's nothing like having a good example in the house, too, right? Right. And on that topic, I'm not sure if all of your parents are here, but if your parents aren't here, of these fine young people, could you stand up, too? Who are those of you who are here today? We're going to wrap up because time is of the essence. I want to thank you. I've been inspired. I'm going to go back to pursuing my dream of owning a professional football team in Hawaii right after I get off the air with Tom Joyner. But I really want to, and I hope you all have garnered as much from this as some of us have, older people have today. Just in closing, if there's something we did not touch on, a last thought that you all would like to leave with your audience. I don't know who wants to go first, but we can go in any particular order. But if you have anything you would like to leave with the audience today. Brian? Rice?
I'll go first. Last thoughts. I wish everybody could grow up with two great parents, two great role models. You know, they have great jobs, they live in a great community. But that's not reality for everyone. Whether you're raised by a single mother struggling with whatever, whether you're raised in foster care, whether you go to a bad school, no matter what the situation is, you have to learn to bloom where you are planted. There has never been a diamond that didn't come from the dirt. There has never been a rose. There's nothing more beautiful than a rose that grew from a beat-up sidewalk. There's never been a champion without a testimony. You are that diamond, you are that rose, you are that champion. You have to make it. You have to bloom where you are planted. Don't make any excuses. Those may be reasons, but do not allow them to be your excuse. You can be whoever you want to be. Step into your dream, connect to your dream, connect to your future, work out a plan, and go after it. You are the dream, you are the success story. You are the future. Be it. And I'm going to finish right
now.
I don't know whose idea it was, but Brian.
It was Brian who stepped out there. You know, buddy, I said, I might as well go because I know Brian's going to leave me.
Well, he pretty much said a lot, but for me, I would honestly say surround yourself with positive people. They say birds of a feather flock together. You're going to be a bird of any feather, let it be an eagle. Let it be not a bird that can't get off the ground. Don't be the chicken, be the eagle.
Thank you, Brian.
Just echo what she just said. That's exactly the route that I was going to go down. Surrounding yourself by positive individuals is probably the best thing you can do for yourself. Again, going back to the fact that having the motivation in yourself is number one. If you can believe in yourself, you can do anything. But having positive individuals around you just makes it that much easier. It's really difficult to do everything by yourself. We do live in a society in which, you know, the people to move forward. So keeping your relationships in good standing and being able to draw on them in your times of need will pay dividends throughout your entire life. So something that I recommend is don't burn any bridges, be nice to as many people as possible, and surround yourself by positive individuals.
Usually when I speak, my closing message is that if I can do it, so can you. Today, it has a broader definition, so you know, make your own it. It doesn't have to be stocks or finances, but just know that I'm nothing special. I'm not a genius. I'm not a whiz kid. Just because I'm up here in a suit doesn't make me any different from anyone else. And I think it's easy to be a spectator and to clap and say, oh, good for them. They're so wonderful. And see, you know, Brandon and Jordan say, oh, they're so cute in their little outfits. But to know that Brandon and Jordan are normal kids that work hard and that you can start your own business at 10 and 14 years old. And just know that, you know, don't just be a spectator. Be a doer. Go out and whatever it is, just take action today.
I want to encourage all of you guys to think and set your dreams and goals now, even at a young age, and write them down also. I always remember that our basketball coach would make us type out all of our goals and print them out, bring them to practice, read them to each other, and then when we went home, he would make us print out multiple copies, have to stick them on our mirror, on our bed, everywhere on our front door, in the kitchen, so that everywhere we went in the house, we'd always be reminded of what our goals and aspirations are. And it's also great to have someone with you, a friend or your parents, to help you and keep you accountable for your goals and what you want to achieve in the future.
Follow your passions, what you have today, kind of identify what you like to do and kind of pursue that. And also, you know, keep your parents and your mentors close because they're going to help you throughout your everyday life. So you need to be able to have those people in your life and they're going to push you to do the great things that you're going to pursue in your life.
Ladies and gentlemen, please.